i-netradio.com. i-netradio.com.
Dobry den, I dobro pozdravljam. This is Springtime in Moscow with your host, James Tuthill, and I'm Stefan Simpson. We've got some Russian with a little American, and we're serious with a little humor. So, Jim, what is happening in the world today?
Steve, thank you for the beautiful introduction. I'm Jim Tuthill, and this is Springtime in Moscow. Today, we have our special, regularly scheduled show, Cooking in the Studio Kitchen with Nerisa Waterman. And today, we are going to Morocco, for some Casablanca recipes and specialties. I want to remind everybody that we're here on i-netradio.com. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, broadcasting from the Gold Coast of Florida between South Beach, Miami Beach, and to the North Palm Beach in beautiful tropical Jupiter, Florida. We have a regularly scheduled brand new show every weekday at 1, 4, 7, and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard and New York time. And of course, that is when Nerisa's show is going to play. We also have the Classical Music Hour with Christina Botnari every weekday at 12 noon and 8 p.m. Eastern Standard and New York time. I want to say hello not only to Nerisa Waterman, our fabulous cook and host, but guess who dropped by the studio? Robert DeLuce. Nerisa and Robert, how are you doing?
Hi, James. Hi, Robert.
Hi, James. Hi, Nerisa.
Good to hear from you guys. This is beautiful. I love having you with me. This is great. This makes my day when we can get together here in the i-net radio kitchen. All right, Nerisa, give us a little bit of a background of Morocco. Where is it? What are we doing with it? And why are we so interested in their food?
Well, I thought it would be a nice exotic place to take our listeners to. Morocco is one of the most diverse countries in Africa. A lot of high mountains, beautiful deserts, beautiful people, exotic spices, and I figured, hey, why not Morocco? So that's where I'm taking you guys today.
Oh, beautiful. And you know, the capital is Rabat, and I knew a beautiful woman from Rabat. She was beautiful, beautiful. And Casablanca is the most famous city, but Rabat is much prettier and much nicer. And Casablanca, of course, was the title of the famous movie. And we have the ancient winding alleyways, and it is beautiful. You know, Nerisa, they have a combination over there of Moroccan and North African cooking together with French cooking, because the French protected Morocco for about 100 years. And a lot of French cooking is mixed with the North Africa cooking. It's really beautiful. Beautiful.
Okay.
Yes.
Well,
we're going to love it. And it's a hot vacation spot. You know, she was always trying to get me to go to Morocco, but I just never made it over there. But you never, this is maybe as close as I'm ever going to get to Rabat, you know, right here on this show. So let's get the flavor. Okay, Nerisa, take us off to Morocco's national drink.
Well, of course, you know me. I have to introduce you to the national drink, and their national drink is tea. Mint tea, to be exact. It's mint tea, and it's a mixture of a green tea, and it's a very interesting process, and they call it the Berber whiskey, jokingly, because, you know, it's something that you can't go to Morocco and not have mint tea.
Mm.
So, and of course, after we're done with the mint tea, I'm also going to make you a mint tea cocktail, because, you know, you can't go to Nerisa's kitchen and not have a cocktail. Yep. So first, I'm going to start you guys off with the mint tea. So we're going to start with loose gunpowder green tea. And if you don't have a Moroccan pot, any teapot would do.
Yes, really, now this is loose. This isn't in one of those little bags, is it?
This is loose green tea.
You see that, Robert? Yes. I always thought tea came in a bag, but here it is, scattered all over the table here.
I think she's got a filter in her pots. Isn't
yes.
that correct, Nerisa?
Yes.
Yes, I do. And we have beautiful mint leaves. And if you can't find the spearmint, you can use peppermint. And if you cannot find the Moroccan mint tea, sometimes you're able to find it, depends where you live and what's available in your farmer's market. But any mint tea leaves will do. But we're using fresh mint. That's very important. And we have a half a cup of sugar here. And you're going to sweeten to your taste. But usually this traditional mint tea, it has a sweet taste to it. Tend to like it sweet. So we're going to fill this beautiful pot with 2 to 3 cups of boiling water. And we have our loose green tea here. And we're just going to leave it for about 30 seconds. And then we're going to swish it around the pot. We're cleaning the tea leaves here. So we're going to swish it around and we're going to discard the water. Not the tea leaves, just the water. And then we're going to add more boiling water to the teapot. And then we're going to add our gunpowder green tea. And we're going to add our sugar. And we're going to let this steep for a while, for maybe 1 to 2 minutes.
Gunpowder green tea. Wonder where that comes from. Gunpowder.
I have. It's an interesting name. I don't know of any substitution that may work. I've always used gunpowder green tea when it comes to making the traditional Moroccan mint tea.
Now, Nerisa, up in Long Island, New York, everybody grew a little bit of mint in their gardens, and I think it was fairly easy to grow. It just came out of the ground, Robert. You didn't have to do a darn thing to it. All of a sudden, it just appeared. But Nerisa, you say that when mint is scarce, you can also use one of my favorites, bitter wormwood, also known as absinthe, which I know about, or Sheba. Mm-hmm. Whew, what's bitter wormwood? Sounds good.
Well, I always make sure I have mint on hand. I actually have 2 mint pots in my window. So
yes.
It's never scarce in my household. But yes, that is a good substitute.
Yes. So, now, where did we get these mint leaves? Did we have to get these from California or somewhere?
From your local farmer's market.
Yeah, but I wonder where they got them, because you don't usually see that here in Florida too much. I don't know.
I don't know.
But they got them. God bless the Du Bois farms. Now, Nerisa, go easy on that sugar. When I go into these southern restaurants, they always say, oh, do you want sweet tea? And man, they can really make it sweet. So please go easy on that sugar. A half a cup of sugar you've got here in front of me. Woo!
They say sweetened to taste. It's optional. And I know I will go less on the sugar.
Yes.
But basically, it's a simple process. It's a quick process. 1 teaspoon of gunpowder to every 6 ounce of hot water. And with the tea, you let it steep for like 1 to 3 minutes. And you have your mint tea, which is usually served to every guest. Every restaurant, like I said, it's their national drink. You cannot go to Morocco and not have their traditional mint tea. It's just not.
Well, it's starting to boil. I see these little bubbles bubbling. And I guess it's 1 teaspoon of loose tea for every 6 ounces of hot water. Is that it?
Correct.
Beautiful. Beautiful. I guess our pot was clean already. We try to be clean here in the I-Net Radio studio.
We're using the traditional glass pot because we don't have the traditional metal tea Moroccan pot. I couldn't locate it. It was impossible to find.
No.
So I'm sure if I had more time, I would have been able to find one. So that process, thank goodness, was eliminated.
If you had told me, I would have driven down to Boca Raton today or Delray Beach and gotten that, because I know somebody that has a Moroccan teapot. Yes. I don't know if she would have given it to me, Robert.
You might have had to fight.
You might have had to fight for that one. You know, you don't always leave on the best of terms, but I would have tried to get that teapot. Yep.
Nerisa, what's good about this kind of tea here with the loose tea leaves is you actually can drink it after it hits boiling, correct? Unlike tea bags where you've got to wait, what, 5 minutes?
Well, yeah, like I said, maybe 60 seconds to maybe 2 minutes. You can let it steep. Mm. It depends on how strong you want it. Yes. And we know that James does not want it sweet, but correct.
Okay.
You can drink it right
now. It's boiled. Now what do we do?
Well, we're going to pour it in these beautiful glasses that we have here.
Yes, we do have nice glasses. We may not have a Moroccan teapot, but we have beautiful glasses. Yes. This is going to be great. And you know, tea's good for you if you have a little cold or something.
Do you even want sugar, James? Should we just eliminate this sugar?
Well, none for me. What about you?
No, I'm going to go straight. I'm just going to go straight tea.
Straight tea for both of us. No sugar.
We're going to eliminate the sugar because I am actually not going to participate in this tea, you guys, because I want to try the Moroccan mint cocktail.
Well, wait a minute. We can have both, Robert.
Yeah, why wake up? Why wake us up just to give us liquor later?
Yeah.
So as you can see, I have my favorite mason jar shaker, and I'm going to a Moroccan mint tea cocktail. So as you can see, 4 whole mint leaves, we have 4 ounces of sweetened iced tea, 2 ounces of vodka, and I'm going to put in a splash of lime juice into the shaker with our ice, and we're going to shake, 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 pour into this beautiful chilled glass, and I'm going to garnish with the mint sprigs. And over here, I have some lemon and lime wedges, and I'm just going to garnish this with a lime wedge. And this is my Moroccan mint tea cocktail.
Now, I see you're using standard vodka from Russia.
Yes.
Yes, I kept that. You know, this started off as Russian radio, and we used to have vodka every day in the studio. But then when we sort of slowed down on the Russian thing, we stopped drinking on the set. So we've got some left here.
We still do the Russian dance, though.
Yeah, we still dance Russian. Yep. Now, this looks pretty good, Nerisa. This looks pretty good. I like this.
Well, should I make one for you and Robert as well?
Yes.
Thank you.
I mean, because you are drinking the traditional mint tea, so do you actually want both?
Yeah.
I've got a cold, and I don't want to give it back to James.
Right. And that vodka. But you know, Nerisa, one thing puzzles me. Moroccan and vodka? Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. Vodka is more of an Eastern European affair.
Well, that's the ingredient, vodka. So
that's
guess
it. You got this straight from the Moroccan authorities. Okay.
I did. That is one of their drinks. And there is another one.
Yes.
Should we even make another drink? Maybe we should just stick with the Moroccan cocktail and the Moroccan tea and start cooking. How about that?
Well, at the end of the show, we could make it.
What do you think?
The vodka kind of reacts pretty quick.
Yeah. After we go off the air, Nerisa, I hate to tell all of our listeners, things get exciting in the studio with all these drinks. Yes. Yes.
Okay, we're going to start cooking.
We're going to start drinking. Here's to you, Robert.
Here's to you, James.
Thank you. Okay.
Enjoy.
Thank you. Here's to your health, Robert.
A traditional.
Thank you.
Here's to you also.
Happy days. As we say in Russia, Nostrovia. As we say in Morocco, Bashkabushka.
Bashkabushka.
Bashkabushka. We used to say that when I took this woman out. Bashkabushka.
Okay, we're going to just stop at this cocktail, and we're going to start with the couscous.
Okay.
Now, we're going to make 2 couscous today. I'm going to make a simple, quick couscous. It'll take you 10 minutes or less, and I'm going to make the traditional couscous. The traditional couscous is not for the faint of heart. It is time-consuming. It is a labor of love. So I'm going to read the ingredients to you first. This traditional couscous is it's loaded with slow-cooked lamb, poached vegetables, and spices, and a generous amount of cumin. So we're going to start with the ingredients for the lamb broth. We have a half a cup of olive oil plus 3 tablespoons for sautéing, 2 large onions, which are thinly sliced. We have a pinch of saffron, maybe about 30 threads. We have a tablespoon of ground ginger, 1 stick of cinnamon, 1 tablespoon of ground coriander, 1 tablespoon of paprika, 2 tablespoons of freshly cracked black pepper, 2 tablespoons of kosher salt, 6 medium cloves of garlic crushed and coarsely chopped, and we have 3 pounds of lamb shanks. We have 2 tomatoes, which was cut in very large pieces, and we have 2 small turnips, and we have 1 large red bell pepper, which is cored, seeded, and is cut. We have 1 bay leaf, 10 sprigs of fresh cilantro, and we have 10 sprigs of flat leaf parsley tied with a kitchen twine. This is for the broth. We're going to also make something called a harissa, which is a hot sauce or a kind of a paste. It's used in North African cuisine and it's made from chili peppers, paprika, and olive oil. And the recipe for the harissa is 2 roasted red bell peppers, 5 dried red chilies, which we soaked in hot water for 20 minutes. We also have 2 cloves of garlic, 2 teaspoons of ground cumin, 1/2 teaspoon of ground coriander, 1 teaspoon of kosher salt, and 1/2 a cup of extra virgin olive oil. So this is the recipe for the harissa. And then for the couscous and the seasoned water in which we're going to cook this couscous, the ingredients for that is 2 cups of flour. And we're going to mix that with 2 cups of water. We have 4 cups of couscous, 3 tablespoons of extra virgin olive oil, we have 30 threads of saffron, 1/2 a teaspoon of ground turmeric, 1 teaspoon of ground cumin, 2 teaspoons of kosher salt, 1/4 teaspoon of freshly ground black pepper, and we have a 15-ounce can of chickpeas, and we're going to drain the chickpeas. We have 1/2 a cup of golden raisins, 1/2 a teaspoon of ground cinnamon, and 2 tablespoons of unsalted butter. We're also going to caramelize the onions for this dish. And we have 3 tablespoons of olive oil, 2 large onions thinly sliced, 2 tablespoons of ground cinnamon, 2 tablespoons of freshly ground black pepper. We have kosher salt to taste. However, I probably will be using 1 teaspoon and 2 tablespoons of granulated sugar and 1 cup of golden raisin. And this is for caramelizing the onions. And for our vegetables, we have 8 baby carrots peeled and cut in 1/2 inches, 1 large sweet potato, 1 pound of winter squash. We have a medium red cabbage, 6 baby eggplants, and 4 small zucchinis. And these are the ingredients that we need for today for our vegetables, our caramelized onion, our couscous, our harissa, and our lamb broth. So we're going to start. Are we ready?
I guess we're ready. We are totally in suspense here because you are in charge on this one, Nerisa.
Okay, so for the broth, in a large bowl, we're going to combine 1/2 a cup of the olive oil with the onions, the spices, the salt, the garlic. And we're going to mix these ingredients very well. We're going to heat the remaining 3 tablespoons of the olive oil in a stock pot over a medium-high heat. Now the shanks, they're already seasoned with salt and pepper, and now we're going to brown them on all sides in batches because we don't want to overcrowd the pan. So we're going to brown these in batches. And then we're going to reduce the heat to medium and then add the seasoned onion mixture. And then we're going to stir occasionally until the spices release their flavors. And that's going to take about 5 minutes. And, you know, after the 5 minutes, we're going to, you know, add the tomatoes, the turnips, the red pepper, and we're going to stir to coat until the tomatoes are soft. And that's going to take another 5 to 8 minutes. We're going to add our bay leaves, we're going to add our herbs, and then we're going to add water to cover it, which is about 10 to 12 cups. We're going to cover the pot and bring to a boil. And then we're going to lower the heat to simmer and cook. We're going to stir occasionally until the lamb pulls apart from the bone easily. And that is going to take about 2 hours. So that might not be something that we're going to eat right now on air.
Oh, I guess we're not going to eat that right now. Now, lamb is a big thing over in Morocco, isn't it?
Yes, it is. So after it's all cooked, we're going to transfer it to the platter, and we're going to continue to simmer the broth until it's full of flavor. And we're going to reduce the broth to about 8 cups. And we're going to add salt and pepper to taste. I know how you feel about salt, James.
That's okay.
It's to taste. And we're going to discard the herbs and the bay leaf and the cinnamon stick, and we're going to spoon off the fat off the surface. So while that is cooking the broth, we're going to let the broth cook. We're going to move over and we're going to make the harissa. We're going to coarsely chop the roast peppers. And we're going to put them in a blender. We're going to add the chilies, not the seeds, the garlic, the cumin, the coriander, and the salt. And with the blender running, we're going to add the olive oil in a stream until the mixture becomes smooth. And that's about 30 seconds. And then we're going to transfer the harissa to a boil and stir in the chili seeds. And that is your harissa. That is our nice spicy chili paste that we're going to add to this mixture later on. Now for the couscous. This is a different way of cooking couscous than I'm used to. They use a method called the fluff method, and they use steam to cook the couscous. So here we go. We're going to have in our medium bowl, we're going to mix the flour and the water to make a thin paste, and we're going to set aside. Here we have, as you can see, three strips of cheesecloth long enough to wrap around twice around the rim of the bowl. We're going to put the couscous in this very large bowl. We're going to cover the grains with cold water, and we're going to switch to remove the starch. Then we're going to drain. We're going to let the couscous rest for about 5 minutes. Meanwhile, we're going to start making our seasoned water, and we're going to mix the oil, the saffron, the turmeric, the cumin, the salt, the pepper, and 3 cups of water. And we're going to fill this stock pot with at least 2 inches of plain water. And we're going to bring it to a boil. Now, as the plain water is heating up, scoop up some of the couscous with your hands. Yes, your hands. We're going to rub the grains together lightly to separate them and break them apart with any lumps. The couscous will feel dry, so we're going to sprinkle a bit of seasoned water and continue to separate and fluff the couscous with our hands. We're letting the grains rub against one another and drill it back into the bowl. We're sprinkling a bit more of the liquid and we're continuing to rub so the couscous starts to feel moist, but not wet. No liquid should accumulate in the bowl. If liquid is accumulating in the bowl, you're using too much liquid. So we're doing a steam and fluff method with cooking the couscous. So we're setting the colander over the simmering water and we're sprinkling the couscous into the colander without pressing on the grains. Wet the long strip of cheesecloth, then dip it into the flour water paste. Wrap the cheesecloth twice around the gap between the colander and the stock pot to steam. We're going to make a seal because we're using the steam to actually cook the couscous. Now, while the couscous is steaming, we're going to heat the olive oil. And here now we're going to start caramelizing our onions. We're going to throw in a few slices of onion, cinnamon, pepper, salt, sugar, and raisins. And we're going to stir and we're going to cook for at least 20 minutes until the onions are caramelized. We're going to reduce the heat and we're going to carefully unwrap the hot cheesecloth around our colander now. So now we're going back to the couscous and we're going to put this couscous in a large bowl. We're breaking up the clumps with a spoon now. When the couscous is cool enough to handle, we're going to fluff again with our hands. And we're going to moisten the couscous gradually by adding liquid to it. And we're going to repeat this method again for a second time. And after we complete this method for the second time, we're going to put our couscous in a dish. And we're going to go back to our veggies and our lamb. And when they're completely cooked, we're going to dump the veggies and the lamb in the middle of the couscous, because as you can see, we're going to put like a little hole in the middle of the couscous. And that is the traditional way of making couscous. It's not as easy as the 10-minute couscous that I'm usually making when I go to the supermarket, but that is the traditional Moroccan couscous.
Okay. Wow.
It's a lot of work to make.
How would you describe the Finnish couscous? I mean, what exactly is it when you're finished with it?
It's going to be a beautiful, flavorful, to me, personally, it reminds me of a stew.
Yes.
And but it takes time, the seasons and all the veggies and the onions, everything has to marry. And the only way you can get the really true appreciation for all the labor of love into this dish and everything that's going in, it takes time to cook. It has to simmer. And, you know, like I said, between 2 and 2.5 hours, we'll be able to eat the traditional couscous.
And you're right. It really is a stew from looking at what I'm seeing here. It's a stew. Very interesting. Okay.
However, I think we'll go back to the quick method, which I appreciate so much more now, which is simple. 1 cup of couscous, 1 cup of water. You bring the water to a boil in a saucepan. You stir in the couscous. You remove from the heat, and you let stand for 5 minutes. That is couscous that I am used to. Less than 10 minutes.
Nerisa, I even have a simpler couscous recipe.
Really?
I have 2 cups of vegetable broth or chicken broth, 2 tablespoons of butter, and 2 cups of couscous.
Oh, I've never tried putting butter in the couscous before.
No?
No, I've never done that before.
Yeah, you bring the broth to a boil in a medium saucepan, and then we add the butter. We've got 2 cups of vegetable broth. And we stir until the butter is dissolved. And while the broth is boiling, we add the couscous. And this is what you do. You turn off the heat, cover it, and let it stand for 10 minutes and fluff it with a fork and serve it. Boy, Robert, that is quick.
It's quick and it looks tasty. But, Nerisa, maybe you want to explain what couscous is to people that aren't actually watching the show today.
Yeah. Go through this couscous again with us.
Okay, couscous. It's a grain. It's not rice. It's not pasta. It's kind of it's a grain that is a staple in Morocco, and they use it to make their traditional Moroccan dish. And like I said, there's the simple method and there's the long-winded method of making the traditional couscous. And usually what we're doing is we're flavoring the couscous itself with whether it's the broth from a vegetable broth or a beef broth or a lamb broth, but that's the main, I guess, the star of the show, the couscous. And then we add different things to it. Some add raisins and apricots and beef, whatever. It depends on what region you're from, determines the type of traditional couscous that you have. But this is their traditional couscous in regards to with the harissa and the lamb. Because like we said before, a lamb is a big thing in Morocco.
Now, we went to the Middle Eastern store in West Palm Beach for this couscous. You just can't get this granulated grains in any store. What do you think, Nerisa?
There are some couscous that you can buy in your regular supermarket. If you go into your authentic aisle in your supermarket. There are some brands that are popular in the supermarket with the quick method in regards to couscous, which I'm familiar with. I can't think of the name brands right now. But couscous is quite popular. It is popular. So you should be able to find couscous in your supermarket.
Now, would you consider couscous a side dish to the stew that we had going before?
I would consider it a side dish. I think so.
Yeah. Yeah. It's pretty starchy, huh?
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's filling a meal on its own.
Yeah.
You don't need anything to go with this. But this is one of their traditional family, meals. Couscous.
It certainly is.
But now, like I said, it's a labor of love.
Now, how does all of this relate to tagine or tagines?
Okay. Tagine is a clay pot.
Yeah.
Where they do most of their cooking in regards to beef or any kind of lamb or chicken or stew. So that's where the comes from. So we have 2 recipes, and one we're going to use the tagine pot, another pot one we're going to use a slow cooker. So we have a vegetarian tagine dish. And like I said, in Morocco, it's very popular. It's a clay pot, beautiful clay pots, by the way.
Yeah, I'm told that they serve this in roadside cafes and even the finest dining rooms in Rabat.
Yes. Mm. So, you know, they cook the stew and they cook the meat till it's tender and the vegetables and everything's just blended and it's in this pot and it's beautiful.
Mm.
So we're going to start with the vegetable tagine. So here we have 3 tablespoons of olive oil, 1 small onion diced, 1 tablespoon of garlic minced, 1 tablespoon of ginger grated. We have 3 cups of squash and 1 can of garbanzo beans.
Okay, now, squash is like zucchini, right?
Yes.
And garbanzo beans. I haven't had those in years, Robert.
Mm. Don't they bounce?
Yes, you can bounce them. Mm-hmm.
Okay, is that the Moroccan tea? They bounce? Okay, and then we have 2 tablespoons of ground turmeric, 2 tablespoons of ground cumin, 2 tablespoons of ground coriander. I have a 2 spoon of ground cinnamon. We're going to use vegetable broth because this is a vegetarian tangine. And we're going to have 1 tablespoon of harissa, 1.5 tablespoon of honey, 1/3 cup of dry apricots. We're going to chop these, 1/3 cup of raisins, 1/3 cup of silvered almonds, and we have preserved lemon. And if you don't have the preserved lemon, you can use 2 tablespoons of fresh lemon juice. It's not actually the same, but it is a great substitute.
Now, almonds, raisins, apricots, and lemons, those are grown in Morocco.
Yes.
Did you know that, Robert?
I knew most of it was.
My friend, her father was a jeweler in Morocco, but he had a huge 500-acre ranch, and they used to grow apricots and lemons out there. I don't know about almonds, but wow. So to all of our listeners in I-Net Radio World, we've got honey, apricots, raisins, almonds, lemons. Woo! And now you're going to get into something even better here. The 4 cups, you tell them what we're going to put 4 cups of, Marisa.
Well, we have a choice because we have both items here. We can use 4 cups of sweet potatoes or 4 cups of pumpkin. Which one would you prefer?
I like pumpkin. You know why? Because it's the holiday season. And we've had Halloween. Thanksgiving's coming up. And we're going to have pumpkin pie.
Perfect timing.
Oh.
I love pumpkin pie.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to use the 4 cups of pumpkin. We have salt to taste. It's actually optional. And the extra, we have extra almonds just for garnishing. So we're going to heat the oil in the large tangine. And like I said, if you don't have that, you can use a Dutch oven. We're going to add the onion and we're going to saute until translucent. And that is about 5 minutes. We're then going to add the garlic and then the ginger and saute for an additional 2 minutes. We're going to add the turmeric, the coriander, the cumin, the cinnamon, and we're going to stir and combine and saute. After that, we're going to add our vegetable broth, our harissa, our honey, our raisins, almonds, and lemon juice. We're going to stir and combine, and we're going to bring to a boil, and then we're going to reduce the heat to low and cover and simmer for 10 minutes. And after that, we're going to add our sweet potatoes. Or our pumpkin, we've decided on pumpkin.
Pumpkin, yes.
We're going to stir, and we're going to reduce to simmer, and we're going to heat to low, and we're going to cover and simmer for about 25 minutes until the pumpkin is fork tender. And that is your vegetarian tangine. So this, we should actually be able to eat before the show is over, because it should take about 25 minutes.
Nerisa, you've got to have a lot of ingredients on hand. Olive oil, onion, garlic, ginger, 1 pound of chicken wings. I suppose that's easy. And then you get to turmeric and cumin and coriander and cinnamon, chicken broth, garbanzo beans, harissa, honey, apricots, raisins, almonds, lemon, sweet potatoes, or we like pumpkin. And wow, that is going to be really, really something. Wow.
Yes. Well, the chicken wings would have been if we didn't make a vegetarian. But for this one, we're going to make the vegetarian. So the chicken wings we're actually going to use in our chicken tangine recipe.
Yes, that's right. We're vegetarians on this one. There were so many ingredients. I just got going. I got on a roll here. And now we're gonna drink tea throughout this dinner.
No, well, you have your mint cocktail as well, and there is another one coming up.
Okay, we're gonna get that. Okay. Now you can actually serve the tagine and the stew sort of together at the same time, and the side dish of those grains.
Huh. Yes, you can. You can.
Wow, this is gonna fill you up.
Well, we're making a Moroccan feast, so whatever you want, you can try, and whatever you don't want,
Well, what do they do? Do they eat in the? I think they eat in the middle of the day. I don't think they eat this at night. I think they eat it around between 12 and 2, don't they?
That's what I believe as well. Everything is like family style in the middle of the table.
Yes.
And you know, everyone sits down and talk and have fun. And it's just a feast. You know, everyone enjoys everything. And
this is fabulous food, but yes, you need to eat this in the middle of the day. I don't think you should go to bed an hour after having one of these dinners.
I think you're going to need a nap after this.
Yes. Yes.
A lot of food.
I think tomorrow we're probably going to have a wonderful lunch. I don't think we're going to be able to eat everything tonight. But I think tomorrow we're all going to sit down, the whole iNet Radio family, and we're going to have a wonderful Moroccan feast.
I just want to tell our listeners, that's Tagine, T-A-G-I-N-E. And are you going to post these recipes?
Yeah, the recipes will be posted on Saturday and Sunday at MiojoSistersWebs.com.
Okay.
Everything will be listed.
Including the couscous. Yes.
Including both couscous recipes.
Yes. Both
all
recipes.
Three couscous
the
recipes,
simple one
every
and
recipe
the
that we discussed
hard
today.
One.
Yes.
And the mint tea we're gonna disclose. Yes.
Exactly. And the mint cocktail.
Yes.
That will be there as well.
And we're serving this family style. You're just gonna put these big containers on the table?
That's right.
Yes.
The whole iNet family, we're going to have a Moroccan feast tomorrow.
Oh, this is going to be good.
So kind of a family buffet style.
This is going to be good. This is going to be a pre-Thanksgiving celebratory feast. But don't we have a salad to go with all this? You know, Nerisa, in America, we seem to be salad crazy. Mm.
Yes, there is a salad to go with. And you know what? Salad is generally served before a Moroccan meal. So
yes.
Sometimes it's raw, it's cooked, it's hot, it's cold, it's colorful, but Moroccan meals often begin with some kind of vegetarian-friendly salad. And there's one particular salad that I'm actually fond of that I make quite often. It's a cooked salad made with eggplant, tomatoes, garlic, olive oil, and spices. And it's a very common side dish to many meals, and it's served with crusty bread.
Mm.
So as you can see, we have beautiful French bread on the table, and this is for this particular dish. So here we go. We have one large eggplant sliced, and it's roasted. We have four large tomatoes, peeled, seed, and chopped. Three cloves of garlic, finely chopped. 1/3 cup of fresh cilantro and parsley. We have a tablespoon of paprika, a tablespoon of cumin, and a teaspoon of salt. 1/8 teaspoon of cayenne pepper, but that's optional. And we have 1/4 cup of olive oil, 1/3 cup of water, and we have lemon wedges, which is optional. We're going to mix all the ingredients in a large, deep skillet. We're going to cover and simmer over a medium to medium-high heat for 30 minutes. We're going to stir occasionally, and we're going to adjust the heat if necessary. Now, after this step is completed, we're going to use a spoon or potato masher. I prefer a potato masher. And we're going to crush tomatoes and the eggplants. And if you like, you can use a small wedge of lemon. It can be added to the pan at this time. It's optional. I'm not really for it, but like I said, it's optional. And we're going to continue to simmer and uncover for 10 minutes until the liquid is reduced. And then it can be stirred. And then after that, we're going to heap it in the center of a pan. And then we're going to serve it warm or cold with crusty bread. I personally prefer it warm, but in 30 minutes, you're going to have the best salad with crusty bread. It's a dip, but they call it a salad. But it's delicious. I've had it a few times. I love it, and I think you will love it too.
Well, this is not a typical American salad with iceberg lettuce and tomato and onion, and that's
Morocco
about it, I guess.
Serve the typical iceberg or romaine lettuce salad. They take salad to a whole nother level.
Yes. This is really more than salad. This is really, really something. Now, when you say, excuse me, that you can serve it cold, does that mean then you refrigerate it or you just let it sit for a while?
You just let it sit for a while.
Uh-huh.
I've never, yeah.
Yeah. I wonder what that would be like if you refrigerated this and then ate it. That would be interesting. Wow.
I have not. Well, like I said, I prefer it warm. I've never had it cold.
Yes.
So I couldn't. And I also warm the bread up as well.
Well, I love eggplant. What about you, Robert?
I do. It's one of my favorites. It's very tasty.
Robert and I were talking about zucchini squash yesterday. Mm-hmm. You can cut mm-hmm. that a number of times during the season. It grows back very rapidly, Nerisa. That's a wonderful thing if you want to go make a little garden for yourself. Eggplant can be very plentiful, and I think it's very nutritious. So basically, the two basic ingredients, the vegetable ingredients, are eggplant and tomatoes. And then you have these spices, if we call everything here a spice. And that's it, olive oil and water. I mean, it can't get much easier than that.
Simple. Served at the beginning of the meal.
And it's 30 delicious. Minutes is all it takes. And then you crush and blend your tomatoes in your eggplant. Now, what kind of bread are we going to eat here? I mean, we just can't have any old Wonder Bread here, Robert.
No.
We got to have something pretty significant for this kind of dinner.
I thought French bread would go pretty well with this dish. That's what I prefer.
A crusty bread, you say. A crusty bread.
Nice crusty bread. Nice
now, we're
going
to serve this before we get to the entrees. This really isn't an entree. This is a salad.
Yeah, this is a salad.
Yeah.
So as soon as this is done, you and Robert can enjoy along with your mint cocktails. I think you guys need a little food in you.
I'm going to have another one. Pour some more of that standard vodka, Robert.
I got it.
Yeah. Don't go too crazy on the tea and the mint. Let's just get the vodka in there. Now, Nerisa, how long do you think that the average Moroccan family takes to eat this dinner in the middle of the day? This must be a two-hour process.
Most definitely. I think this is like a two-hour, maybe even 3 hours, because you have your salad, you have your dinner, then you have your dessert.
Yes.
So this is quality time with family and friends. You're drinking your mint tea, you're having your dessert, you're laughing, you're talking. No cell phones, no TV, no outside distractions. It's just all about enjoying each other's company.
Now, what do we treat as the soup here out of all this? What's considered the soup?
Well, we have a recipe for a lentil soup, where we're going to cook in a crock pot.
Yes.
They have a traditional soup, and it's often served as a starter, and the soup itself is as a meal. But for today, what we're going to do is we're going to do a Moroccan lentil soup, and we're going to cook the soup in a crock pot or a slow cooker if you choose. This is not something that we're going to eat today right now on the iNet Radio Show. This soup is going to take about 4.5 hours to cook. So I will give you the ingredients, and we'll get started.
I want to remind all of our iDashNet radio listeners that this sort of Berber soup is popular during Ramadan, which I would consider the high holy days for the Islamic religion and Muslim people. In fact, many people go to Mecca and Medina in Saudi Arabia for Ramadan. As you know, Morocco is a Muslim nation. And look at this, Robert. It's served at dusk to break the fast. That's right. People fast for Ramadan. And what do? They have this soup. Wow.
Wow.
Okay. That's just for any of our Muslim friends. Anyone else? I guess you can have it whenever you like. So tell us about this lentil soup, Nerisa.
Well, this lentil soup, as I indicated, we're going to cook it in the slow cooker. This particular recipe serves 12.
Ooh.
Yes. Serves 12. So this is a family style recipe. This is a meal in itself. It's going to take about 30 minutes to prep, but it is going to take about 4 hours to cook in the slow cooker. And back to the ingredients, we have 2 cups of chopped onions, 2 cups of chopped carrots, 4 cloves, which is minced, 2 teaspoons of extra virgin olive oil, 1 teaspoon of ground cumin, 1 teaspoon of ground coriander, 1 teaspoon of ground cumin, 1/4 teaspoon of ground cinnamon, teaspoon of ground pepper, 6 cups of vegetable broth or reduced sodium chicken broth, choice is yours, 2 cups of water, 3 cups of chopped cauliflower, 1/3-4 cups of lentils, 1 28-ounce can of diced tomatoes, 2 tablespoons tablespoons of tomato paste, 4 cups of fresh spinach, or 1 10-ounce package of the frozen chopped spinach, thawed, 1/2 cup of fresh cilantro, and 2 tablespoons of lemon juice. And this is the ingredients that we're going to put in our beautiful slow cooker. We're going to combine the onions and the carrots and the garlic, oil, cumin, coriander, turmeric, cinnamon, and pepper in our slow cooker, which is about 6 quarts. We're going to add the broth, the water, the cauliflower, the lentils, tomatoes, and tomato paste, and stir well until everything is combined. We're going to cover and cook until the lentils are tender, and like I said, it's going to be about 4 hours, and we're going to cook it on high. We're going to cook it on high, and during the last 30 minutes of cooking, we're going to add the spinach. Just before serving, we're going to also stir in the cilantro and lemon juice. And like I said, this is going to take 4 hours.
I want to warn all of our listeners, from what I see, this is filling enough to be a meal in itself.
Yes, this can stand on its own as a meal itself.
Boy, this is some dinner. This is more like a 4 or 5 hour deal, Robert. This is really something.
I was wondering when they work.
I don't know. Do these people ever work, or do they just eat and drink, Nerisa?
You know, eat and drink, that's work in itself. It takes a lot of energy to eat all these foods.
Yes. So. Nerisa, you're not going to believe this, but we are running close to time here. Let's go to our dessert. Now, I don't know if we're on the same page on some of these things. Are you going to have dates stuffed with honeyed almonds, or do you have another delicacy set for us?
Well, we have a choice. As you know, fruits is also referred to as desserts. So we can have dates stuffed with honey almonds, or you can have honey cinnamon orange, or you can have Moroccan macaroons. The choice is yours.
Wow. Well, hold on a second here, because I'm looking at what you've got out here. Now, you do have some dates and almonds here, and you have a little honey here.
Yes.
That sounds pretty good.
Yes.
What's that all about? That looks good.
Okay. So, I actually enjoy this one myself. It's date stuffed with honey almonds, and it's usually served at the end with mint tea or a very strong coffee. I prefer it with a very strong coffee.
Standard vodka. Okay.
Okay, that's what makes you happy.
Yes.
So we have 20 almonds and 2 teaspoons of honey. In a small pan, we're going to add the almonds and warm over a gentle heat until it starts to color. We're going to take it off the heat, and then we're going to add honey. We're going to let it bubble in the pan, and we're going to return to a gentle heat and bring it back to bubbling until it starts to caramelize. Now be careful, we don't want to burn ourselves with the almonds or the honey. So while they're still hot, we're going to tip the almonds onto a piece of bacon parchment and separate them carefully. They will be hot at this point.
Bacon parchment?
Bacon parchment paper.
Parch paper.
Like wax paper. And like I said, keep in mind the almonds and the dates, they're going to be very hot. So we're going to lump them together, and we're going to just allow them to cool until they become very sticky. And we're going to split the dates lengthwise and remove the stone. Add a sticky almond in the split of each date and lightly press the date together. And like I said, we're going to serve it with mint tea or strong coffee or vodka. But that is your date stuffed with honey almonds.
Mm.
And it's really delicious.
That looks very, very good. I love honey.
Does.
Honey, almonds, and dates. I don't see how you can go wrong with that. Now, I don't want to miss out. What's our final drink here, Nerisa? We were going to have another drink, weren't we?
Yes. Okay, well, there's another drink. It's called Tickled Pink.
Pickled who?
And Tickled Pink.
Pink.
Pink. P-I-N-K. Pink.
Tickled Pink.
Tickled.
You tickle me pink.
Yes.
All right.
And what we're going to do is just simply, it's a layering drink. It's an ounce of white creme de coco and an ounce of grenadine syrup. And we're going to just layer it with a spoon into a lowball glass.
Now, let me slow you down there. We've got white creme de coco, and what's the other ingredient?
Grenadine syrup.
Oh, God, cherry juice like we used to get on a Shirley Temple.
Yum, yum, yum.
Oh, man, I love that.
Those were the days.
Yeah, and white cream de coco. This is going to be something.
So after this, you will be laughing tickle pink. So, but that is our final cocktail.
Well, you know, I was a bartender, seriously, in college. And that would be considered an after-dinner drink with the white cream de coco. No doubt about it.
I think it's a great dessert.
Yes. You got to love that. Now, you stir that, Nerisa? You shake it or what?
No, this is layering. We're going to use the spoon, and we're going to pour in the creme de coco first, and then we're going to add the syrup layer, or you can do vice versa. But the idea is you want to do the layer.
Oh, it's
layer. We're
going to
layer, yes, in a nice low-ball glass, simple, to serve. So we have Moroccan mint tea cocktail, we have tickle pink, and we have our traditional mint tea. And that is the beverage of choice for my Moroccan feast.
Now, you know, as things worked out, we're going to play a little song, a Moroccan song, to put everybody into the mood for eating and dancing and partying and singing. But we do have time for one more dessert. Do you still have another dessert recipe out there, Nerisa?
I would love to do the honey cinnamon orange, because this is actually a dessert that I enjoy myself. Mm. You can tell I like to use honey when it comes to desserts. So we have 2 navel oranges, 2 tablespoons of honey, 2 teaspoons of ground cinnamon, fresh mint leaves, and we're going to just use that for garnish. We've peeled the oranges. We're going to slice these oranges, thick slices. We're going to place on a serving platter, mix the honey and cinnamon in a bowl, and we're going to drizzle the honey mixture over the orange, and we're going to garnish with the mint leaves. And that is our dessert, honey cinnamon orange.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Now, I realize we've only got 3 of us, plus Steve, who's over there in the corner producing this show with the headphones on. He's doing a beautiful job. He's over there eating a piece of cheese, Robert. American cheese, yes. And we're sitting over here eating the greatest delicacies in the world. Okay. Now, you can, of course, in one of these fabulous dinners, I guess you'd have a dozen people at this type of dinner, not just 3 people. You could have a variety of desserts, a variety of drinks. We've got the salad, we've got the soup, we've got a number of entrees here. This is really spectacular. Now, people are going to want to taste all of these dishes, Nerisa. It's going to be hard to stop somebody from not having a little bit of everything, okay? So this is would you consider this a high-calorie dinner?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And what you had even had a third dessert. What was that called? What was that going to be?
It was Moroccan macaroons.
Oh, I love macaroons. Tell me about that. I love those little cookies. Tell me.
But we didn't even get a chance to do the quick Moroccan meatballs.
Wow. Okay. All right, do your best here. We got to go fast because I'm playing a little music here to end this show and put them in the mood.
Okay, here we go. Quick Moroccan meatballs. 1 tablespoon of olive oil. 1 package of ready-made beef or chicken meatballs. You know, those little ones that you see in your frozen department in your supermarket. 1 large onion, thinly sliced. We're going to have dry apricots. You're going to have them. 1 small cinnamon stick. And we're going to have 1 tomatoes, 1 garlic crushed, a handful of coriander leaves, and we're going to chop. We're going to heat the oil in a large frying pan. We're going to fry the meatballs for about 10 minutes, turning occasionally until they're cooked. We're going to scoop out the meatballs, set aside. We're going to cook the onions for 5 minutes until it's softened. We're going to add the dry apricots, the cinnamon, the tomatoes, and water to the pan. Bring a boil, simmer for 10 minutes. Remove the cinnamon stick, return the meatballs to the pan, and coat well with the tomato sauce. Serve with the almonds sprinkled on top. And that is your quick Moroccan meatballs.
Moroccan meatballs. All right, Nerisa and Robert, This is unbelievable. And Nerisa will be posting these recipes where again, Nerisa?
YoHoSistersWebs.com, and they will be posted on Saturday and Sunday.
And how do you spell that?
MyoHoSisters.
MyoHo Sisters.
WEBS.com.
Beautiful.
And it will be posted midnight Saturday and Sunday as well.
Beautiful. Robert, thank you for joining Nerisa and me in the I-Net Radio Studios. We want to thank all of our listeners around the world, from Moscow to Miami to Montgomery, Alabama to Malibu, California. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, Nerisa.
Bye. Thanks.